then how to value a firm? Valuation of a firm. How valuable your firm is? It's very valuable. Very well. How much vary? How? What is vary? How big was Ravan battle? How big was it? Very big. I understand, but how big?
How much?
Very big. You don't understand. Very big. All right. How high is the sky? Very high. How high? How much high? How vast is the ocean? Very vast. How vast? Gaganam. Listen, sir. Gaganam. Gaganakaram. Sagaram. Sagaropamam. Upama. Upama means comparison. Sagaropama means as much as vast as compared. With what do you compare ocean? With ocean only. So, Sagaram, Sagaropamam. Rama Ravanayor Yuddham. Rama Ravanayor Iva. It was as big as that.
Very famous.
So inventory management sublime to the ridiculous. From sublime to the ridiculous. From inventory management, cash management. How valuable is your firm? That valuation of the firm. Ramana Ravaniyo Yuva. How to value a firm? In case of mergers. How risky is your share if you hold one? Is there a relationship between risk and the market price? How is it related? What's the formula for it? Which are the known parameter and unknown parameter? These are the things which I want you to just get excited about. with that, I think we will leave a few gaps as icing on the cake, which can be done tomorrow also. So we begin with cash management. Any gap?
cash.
If you see balance sheet of any company, the cash and bank balance heading in the asset side, the value of it will be the least as a percentage of total assets.
Okay.
It may be in millions of rupees, but as a percentage of the total assets, cash balance will be least. The reason is that cash is an asset which is totally a non-performing asset. Non-performing means by holding cash, you don't get any return. On the contrary, if you hold it as a sort of a liquidity requirement, you may perhaps lose the value of it also over time. So there is a depreciation in the value of money on the one hand, and even as it is, there is no return at all from it at any point of time. Ideally speaking, therefore, you should not hold any cash. But in practice, it becomes impossible to think of a situation where you don't have cash at all, because cash has certain functions to perform for which you have to pay a price by foregoing a return. It may be for speculative purposes you may hold cash. That is, the prices may go up in 2 or 3 weeks if I don't buy the materials today. And so I speculate in inflation, and therefore I need cash to buy. Now, what I don't need now, but I need to buy it. This is speculative. Again, precautionary measure. It is possible that some of the inventories may not be available in the market because of some paucity, P-A-U-C-A-T-Y, of supply. And so I need to hoard the inventory for which I need money, cash. And thirdly, for transactional purposes, on a day-to-day basis. So there are three purposes for which cash is required to be held. One is a transactional purpose, speculative purpose, and precautionary purpose. We have therefore established the fact that cash is required and there cannot be a zero cash position. I should therefore have at any one point of time an understanding of how much cash I should keep each time as an optimum level, not maximum level or minimum level. The word is optimum level, balanced level. That is theory. Now, if I hold cash, I incur a cost. What could it be? Cost of holding cash. What? My own money, my own cash. What is the cost involved in holding cash?
Depreciation.
What's again?
Depreciation.
No,
that's it. The cost is in terms of percentage, in terms of a loss of opportunity. If I had invested it rather than holding it, I would have obtained a return, which by not getting it is a loss, and that is a cost. That's the analysis. So if anybody asks you what is the cost of holding cash, it is the opportunity loss in terms of return surrendered by not investing. In finance, we call it carrying cost. And we denote by the letter C. Supposing A is the total annual requirement per year, cash requirement per year. I estimate it, depending upon my size of business and transactions. Annually, I need to spend for my business, let's say 500 million, 50 million, 5 million rupees. That's an annual requirement, A. But I don't need to hold all of A always, because I will incur what is called carrying cost. Whenever I want, I shall procure cash in my cash box Until then, all the cash that I have, I will invest it in stocks. Stocks meaning instruments. Instruments meaning securities. Marketable securities. For example, RBI bond, repo, or some government securities like treasury bills. These are the 100% safe securities offered by the state government and central government and RBI, giving very small return because it is 100% risk free. Therefore, it is very, very low return because risk and return are inversely proportional. But it is better than getting 0 rupees, so I invest. But whenever I need it, I have to procure it back from the government by selling the securities. And each time I sell a security, I incur a cost called commission for the brokers. Now, sometimes I have to sell away my cash and convert it into securities because I may be running up with high cash, and it is a graph after all, high, low, etc. And this is my median. And anything above this is extra cash which is attracting holding cost. So I offload it. When I offload it by buying securities, I incur an ordering cost. Similarly, when I am dip below the median, I immediately sell the security and rectify the imbalance. Selling involves commission, and that is again ordering cost. So commission paid to the brokers for selling or buying both of the securities in order to come back to equilibrium position of cash are called, the costs are called ordering cost. That is, what is it that I am ordering? Cash. I am procuring cash. I am on tap, I should have cash. So I am ordering, I am clapping, and that is the cost. And I consider it as carrying the ordering cost as O. So O is the ordering cost. Immediately after this, I will give you a simple arithmetical example that will solidify your learning. But certain elementary variables have to be understood. A-O. And then, what should I have as optimum, I told you, not maximum, not minimum, optimum cash at any point of time to meet all these three requirements. What are they? Transactional, precautionary, and
speculative.
In order to meet these three, I need some cash always. How much should it be? That is, economic order quantity of cash. Neither zero nor infinite. That optimum, which I said. EOQ, economic order quantity. That is, each time commencing from zero, I should pick up the phone and tell my broker, send me 50 lakhs. From there. I've already got securities. I told the broker to come, pick up the security, go to the market, sell it, and give me 50 lakhs. I'll give you commission. This is called ordering cost. And that 50 lakhs which I hold will incur what? Carrying cost. The carrying cost is C. If I graphically show this, and this being cost, this being quantity of anything, cash is a quantity, cash is a material. Now, if I hold least quantity, the cost, that is the opportunity loss, that is the carrying cost, is very high.
This will be total cost. So this is total cost. This is quantity.
Total cost is what? Carrying cost plus ordering cost. How do you think these two are related? If I want to avoid ordering cost, that means what? I should order least number of times. That means I should have high holding the fudge, so that I need not order every other day. I am avoiding ordering cost by incurring carrying cost. And in order to avoid carrying cost, I should keep on ordering frequently and I shall be incurring ordering cost. So they are inversely related. The optimum position has to be from them.
Now one will be in this form, other cost will be like this. The cost keeps climbing down if the carrying, if the quantity comes down the other way. Now this is the optimum point. Now the total cost curve is something like this.
Correct? I think we have done it in mathematics, elementary mathematics.
And then you will also perhaps remember that this trough, that it is called, will coincide with the and this point of intersection is the optimum quantity. The perpendicular intersecting on the x-axis will be, that is the mathematics of it. If you remember this much which you have done, in one form or the other you have done it in some time or the other, yes. The declining, what's that, exponential decline, logarithmic ascent, all mathematics is simple. Now my job is to ascertain the quantity Q, which I call economic order quantity or EOQ. What is that? That is the optimum quantity which I shall be holding at any point of time in my cash box, which will, listen, which will minimize the total cost. It can't eliminate. There is a cost because there is some cash. If you have understood the problem, solving it is not an issue. Now just look at this equation. Applying these parameters, annual required divided by Q will be the number of times you will be ordering.
If 100 rupees is my total annual requirement of cash, and I order I need economic order quantity, which I don't know, I am solving it. That is the x here in this equation. I have not yet known. I have only identified, that is my task to find out what is the value of x, Q. So A divided by Q becomes a number, number of times I order. And A by Q multiplied by each order cost is what is A over by Q. This is the total ordering cost. Simple? Sir?
Yes.
Plus Q by 2 is the average holding at any given point of time in my cash. I start with 100 rupees in the beginning of the year. I keep on reducing it and it will become 0. And then at any one point of time, the average between Q and 0 is Q by 2. And that is the holding cost to be multiplied by the holding cost or carrying cost. Q by 2 basically. This is the total cost. It is not complicated, it is not complex. You just go systematically. Very systematically. This is the total cost, and total cost is made up of this element and that. Now I want to find Q, the minimum Q. If you remember calculus again, what do you do?
Differentiate
with respect to Q.
Q. Very easy to teach this kind of thing.
Very easy. But if I am teaching, it is very difficult to learn it. That's my problem.
A O by Q square plus C by 2.
Good, you remember it. Now, if I want to minimize it, what should happen? Minimize the total.
It should be equal to 0.
Correct.
So 0 should be equal to this. First order differential equation should be pushed to 0 in order to minimize the total cost. This is the total cost, so this equation is in place, is equal to 0. And take this equation, solve for Q. You get if I am able to estimate as a manager in the firm, first of all, my required total cash requirement for my business, and the commission payable to the brokers for either selling or buying, I will arrive at a Q which is well advised to me to follow the rule, so that when I cannot avoid A cost and B cost, I can only minimize A plus B cost. And at this particular level of holding cash, namely Q, the total cost becomes minimum. And that Q is economic order quantity of cash. Identify it in the beginning of a financial year. Having identified it, then try to keep close to that Q in your cash transactions. That's all. It's not possible for you to keep on caging it and not allowing it to go up or down. That is a pivotal point. That is the point of anchorage, where the ship has to keep an eye upon and drift. The ship can drift, but keeping an eye on the anchor always. Something like a small baby, which in a crowd of in the family, goes on the lap of any uncle or any aunt, strange uncle and aunt, but always keeping an eye on the mother. Have you noticed it? The psychology of it. It will laugh, it will be cheerful, it will do anything, it will let others fondle it. But always one eye on the mother. Something like ship drifting, with always one eye on the anchor. So a finance manager will have one eye on Q and he will drift. Well, the same thing can be applied for inventory.
Yeah.
I will not have just in time, what is that?
Just in time.
It is just philosophy. Just. In practicality, does it work? For example, I attended a conference of Maruti Udyog Limited when I was in the back, and this was in Gurgaon. Krishnamurti was the chairman of Maruti Udyog then, M. Krishnamurti. Just a diploma holder, he was CEO of, first CEO of Maruti, chosen by Japanese. And Japanese don't understand PhD and MS and MD and all that. They are all diploma mechanics. I have never seen a Japanese person winning a Nobel Prize in physics yet. No need. It's a waste of time. They spend a lot, they tell the West, spend a lot of money.
Sir, this year, Japanese won the Nobel Prize.
In physics?
Yeah, for inventing that LED light.
Oh, LED light, is it?
Yeah. Again, practical.
No, it's not practical. Yeah. It's not concept. It is not some disproving Newtonian what physics is it?
Particle
physics. It is not, it is not for that purpose, it is LED. Then a touchscreen inventor may get another Nobel Prize. Practical. They say we don't waste time on fundamental research. All that Western countries let them spend and let them create a model. We import it, dismantle it, and do a product better than that. And export it to USA. Anyway, coming back. Inventory management. I was saying about this, Krishnamurti. He said, I'll import a portion of Japanese inventory management philosophy into Maruti Udyog in Gurgaon.
what does it mean? He says 3 months holding, 1 month holding, 2 months holding is how we look at in India. Even banks, when they finance cash credit, they will have a fight with the customer and the borrower. Borrower says, I want 4 months of holding of inventory, finance it. Bank says, why 4 months, why not 1 month? They negotiate. Neither of them knows the inventory management, but only because you asked for 4 months, I am offering 1 month. That's all. I asked, it was a very small gathering like this. I was in the bank, doing cash credit. So I said, sir, we have not come across this Japanese inventory. What does it mean, this just in time? It's very simple, you see. All the inventory that I have will only be seen on the conveyor belt. Nothing in the storeroom. In the storeroom, we shall have neither raw material nor finished goods. Because finished goods are not manufactured for showpieces in the storeroom. It is meant for sale. How do you manage it? He says it's very simple. I will establish ancillary units within 3 km radius from my factory of small scale industry. And if the car requires something like 5,000 or 6,000 component parts, I will order these, I will place the order to these small scale industries and ensure and assure them that I will lift one shift load of manufacture. So they are also comfortable about the marketing. One shift is underwritten to sale. But only when I telephone, you should deliver. Otherwise, that one shift load will be in his store. So everyone is very happy. Maruti has underwritten my one shift load. It's more than break even. And they are giving me all the facilities of the infrastructure, the free go down space and the manufacturing space. It turned out all right for some time. Therefore, even in Suzuki company, they have about 6 hours of inventory at a time. 8 hours of inventory at a time. Not even one day. Now I want to import a little bit of Japanese inventory management style into India by applying that rule, by having the ancillary. So in Gurgaon factory, you see the ancillary. Already we have some 1,500 ancillary units. All manufacturing components only for month. Then I said, how will it translate into reality? That in your balance sheet, if I see, what will be the storing of raw material in your balance sheet applying this? Ideally, it should be nil. But I find something. Well, that is only 3 days of stock, that's all, he said. Then I said, if just-in-time principle works, then this is the thing you say, I will telephone it and you deliver, not until then. Then no day in your balance sheet, you should have inventory balance at all. Then he said, you see, telephone systems being what they are in India, I need 3 days to reach 3 km away supply. That's why I keep this 3 days. Do you think it is good management? Why not good if it is not good? Analyze. Just because I answered a question, don't make the opposite view. Are we really solving the inventory management problem for the country?
We are pushing it to the supply.
That's all. Have you solved the problem or have you transferred the problem?
At least the supply side we are transferring.
That's all. It's something like in a public sector unit like SBI. If you have a problematic staff member, you cannot dismiss him. You transfer. And you think you have solved the problem.
solving by transfer.
Yes.
For
a country. Yeah.
For a country.
You see, after all, inventory management is not confined to Maruti Udyog Company. A inventory management is a problem for the country. It is an ideal GDP of the country. It is a non-return yielding GDP of the country. So it's not only necessary that we should have a GDP growth in terms of arithmetic. Manufacture large number of iron ingots from the coal mines and keep them. It is a part of your GDP. But if you keep it as 9 months stock at 100, say 1 year, 2 year stock, GDP is not absolute figure. You see, the return you get from out of the GDP is the what you should aim at. GDP per se is not, should not be the aim. So you're only creating GDP without returns. GDP is gross domestic product of both services and materials, goods and services. But the goods and services, if you manufacture and store, what is the use? So it is a problem of the country. So you are only solving by saying, don't supply me till I ask you. And that fellow is sucking his thumb, constantly looking at the telephone because he has no other customer to sell. This is captive customer.
Yes.
Ambassador company will not buy this. So inventory management takes a very important role to play. And if on the basis of what I told you about cash, inventory is as important as cash. That means you should not hold too much inventory, just like you should not hold too much cash. Similarly, you should not hold a sort of a stock-out position, on the verge of stock-out position, in order to having an insurance stock. Neither. There should be an optimum stock of inventory, just like an optimum stock of cash. Can you apply the same formula, translating where necessary changes are required, and tell me how you can identify an economic order quantity of inventory? Can you?
Like A, we can annual amount of sales or something.
Sales, annual raw material required. Sales, don't, they are not the same thing. Okay. Be very, very clear. It's not sales. It is the annual requirement of raw material.
Inventory from the
For example, if you have budgeted a sale of 100 million,
yes.
Then if your technology is such that 60% of 100 million constitutes raw material,
okay.
Then 60 million is your annual requirement. That is A.
That is A. And then holding cost should be like if,
what is it?
Holding cost.
In the case of cash, what was holding cost?
So
it is opportunity.
Loss. Yes.
In the case of inventory,
probably one is I will pay money and get and that, or probably the inventory that rent, that is the kind of thing. Or probably I ordered earlier itself.
Don't escalate the problem. Okay. Just give within the framework all normal temperature pressure conditions.
Okay.
Answer. If there is a tsunami, don't answer
that.
So just within the frame.
Carrying cost.
What is it? What creates carrying cost? Is the question. Because in the case of cash, the opportunity loss created carrying cost. Similarly, in the case of inventory, what is that thing which creates carrying cost in respect of inventory?
Money had gone inside.
What is that thing which creates carrying cost?
The inventory is not making money.
Sir, when you buy inventory in the market, you need money to buy. You have no money. There is such a thing called cash credit in a bank. There is such a thing called a loan for working capital. You borrow money from the bank to buy your raw material. Nothing comes free. You pay interest. The interest paid for funds borrowed for buying raw material is the carrying cost. That's all. The cash credit or whatever loan you have taken has to be repaid, and there is an interest element in it. So long as you carry the inventory, there is an interest element behind it, and that interest cost is as much as you carry inventory. That is, lower you carry inventory, less is the interest cost, and higher you carry inventory, higher is the interest. Just like higher you carry cash, larger is the opportunity loss. Therefore, C is the interest you pay for funding of the inventory. That's the correct answer. Simple, direct, correct answer. Don't beat about the bush. Okay. Interest is not the only thing. And you attempted something by saying a story.
Yeah.
That is also correct. You go to the godown, you put it in there, and you pay rent for the premises in which you store the inventory. Mm-hmm. That rent per month is a carrying cost.
Yes.
Probably, more inventory you carry, larger is the rent you have to pay because of the space.
Mm-hmm.
Accepted. You can also probably say that there will be a watchman and he has to pay salary, or there will be some anti-fire establishment there. You have to pay. All these are minor. So when you answer a question in finance, capture the A among A, B, C. B and C for. And we are not here accurately calculating the carrying cost. We are having a big picture in mind to determine approximate optimum quantity of inventory. So C is solved. Now O. Ordering cost. What is it? What are the things which create ordering cost in respect of it?